Good morning, everyone. So we are here for our session of a biological series. Today's topic is on nerve cell, brain and spinal cord by our speaker, Ms. Kanupriya. She did master's in biochemistry from Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar. Presently, she is a PhD student in Neuroscience Research Lab, PGIMER, Chandigarh. Her research topic revolves around the analysis of cell survival and stem cell markers associated with mind-body techniques. Along with Kanupriya, we have a very special guest as a commentator for today's presentation, Dr. Gurvatan S. Miranpuri. Dr. Gurvatan Miranpuri is a MSc PhD from Punjab Agricultural University, Ludhiana. He has been working as a senior scientist since 2003 in the Dr. Daniel Resnick Spinal Cord Injury Lab at the University of Wisconsin School of Medicine and Public Health. Developing small and large animal disease models has been Miranpuri's academic passion since 1975. He has been a scientist mentor directing projects to more than 138 undergraduates and graduate students studying small and large domesticated animal disease models, in addition to know-how of managing research animal facility as his past passion in the past. He has been awarded numerous national and international awards, and he is currently appointed on School of Medicine, Public Health, Animal Care, and Use of Committee as voting member. He has more than 135 publications, 85 scientific and technical reports to his credit. So with this introduction, I'm pleased to begin our session and request Kanupriya to upload her presentation. Over to you, Kanupriya.
Thank you, ma'am. A very good evening to all. So the topic of today's presentation is nerve cells, brain and spinal cord. Starting with the very basic of what is nervous system. The nervous system is basically divided into central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. And brain and spinal cord are part of central nervous system. However, peripheral nervous system consists of parts of neurons found outside the central nervous system. So in this presentation, we'll be focusing mainly on the central nervous system, which includes brain and spinal cord. Starting with the very basic unit of the nervous system, which is the nerve cell, also called as neuron. A nerve cell, like any other cell, contains the cell body, which is called as soma. It has various protrusions, which are extended from the cell body. These are very short protrusions called as dendrites, and it has a longer protrusion, which is called as the axon. The axon are covered with a special insulating substance called as myelin, which helps to convey the signal from the nerves. And at the end of the neuron is the axon terminal, which is found at the end of the neuron, and it is involved in the synapse formation, which is the contact or between the two neurons. So this region contacts with the further neuron for the information transfer. So the basic function of the neurons can be concluded as they receive signals or information. They communicate signals to the target cells, which can be the other neurons, which can be muscles or the glands, to which information has to be transferred. So basically, there are three types of neurons: sensory neurons, which get information about what is going on inside and outside of the body and bring that information into the central nervous system so that that can be processed. Motor neurons get information from other neurons and convey commands to the muscle and organ, muscle organs and glands to react to that particular information. Interneurons are those which are found, which connect one neuron to the another. They receive information from one neuron, which can be either sensory neuron or interneuron, and transfer that information to other neurons, which can be either motor neuron or interneuron. So after understanding the structure of neurons, we are now moving to the brain, which is the basic component of the central nervous system. It is one of the largest organ of the body, which coordinates most of the body functions. It is the center of thought, memory, judgment, and emotion. The brain is divided into various parts, and each part of the brain is responsible for controlling different kind of body functions. Brain is a soft tissue, that is why it needs a protection. That is why it is contained inside the skull. And the weight of the brain is approximately, human brain is approximately 1300 to 1400 grams. It is made up of approximately 100 million neurons. So various kinds of information are being transferred from the brain to the body and from body to the brain. So understand, now we know that what are the basic functions of the brain. So how this brain structure is organized, it contains three basic parts, the forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. Forebrain, it consists of olfactory lobes, cerebrum and diencephalon. There is a midbrain, and the hindbrain consists of cerebellum, pons veroli and medulla oblongata. So the basic functions of forebrain, the forebrain contains the largest region of the brain, which is the cerebrum. That is why this is the largest part of the three types of three sets of the brain. So the forebrain consists of olfactory lobes, which as name suggests is involved in the sense of smell. Cerebrum, it is the largest part of the human brain, which is associated with the body movement. It is associated with emotions, sensations, and forebrain has a diencephalon, which includes epithalamus, thalamus, and hypothalamus. These structures are involved in various vital functions, which regulate wakefulness and controls the autonomic nervous system. Hypothalamus, along with hippocampus and amygdala, forms the limbic system, which is called as the emotion center of the brain. In the midbrain, which is present at the center, it is associated with vision, hearing, motor control, sleep, and wakefulness. The hindbrain consists of cerebellum, which is involved in rapid muscular activities such as running, typing, and talking. It is the second largest portion of the brain after the cerebrum. The hindbrain also consists of pons veroli, which relays impulses between different parts of the brain. It also contains medulla oblongata, which receives and integrates signals from the spinal cord and sends them to the cerebellum and the hypothalamus. The spinal cord originates from the medulla oblongata. So after understanding about what are the different regions of the brain, we'll now be moving to the ventricles of the brain. So the brain contains certain cavities in which CSF is present, cerebrospinal fluid. So this cerebrospinal fluid basically provides cushioning to the brain. It provides the nutrients to the brain are transported by the CSF. So this CSF is present in the ventricles of the brain, and there are four types of ventricles which are present in the brain. These are two lateral ventricles, one middle third ventricle, and one is the lower ventricle, which is called as a fourth ventricle. So we have now, till now we have understood the structure of brain cell, which is the neuron. And now we have understood what is brain and what are different regions of the brain. And we have as I have already mentioned, the spinal cord originates from the medulla oblongata region of the brain. So the spinal cord continues down from the medulla oblongata. It consists of thick bundles of nerves, which extend from the brain down through the cavity of the backbone and connects with nerves throughout the body to carry information to and from the brain. Spinal cord provides a means of communication between the brain and the peripheral nerves. It carries many efferent and efferent nerves. Efferent and efferent nerves basically defines that those nerves which are transferring information from different regions of the brain, different regions of the body to the brain, and from brain to the body. Spinal cord, similar to brain, is a soft tissue, so it needs protection, and it is for protection, it is protected by a bony structure called as vertebrae. So to understand more about the spinal cord, this is the cross-sectional structure of a spinal cord. A spinal cord consists of a butterfly-like structure in which there is a gray matter in the center surrounded by the white matter. Since spinal cord is a soft tissue, it needs protection. So various pads and tissues and bony structures provides protection to the spinal cord. So between the tissue layers which are surrounding the spinal cord, there are various spaces like epidural space, subdural space, subarachnoid spaces. So in the subarachnoid spaces, there is presence of CSF in the spinal cord. So this is a another image of the spinal cord for a better visual, in which we can see that this is the spinal cord surrounded by various tissues and the bony structures of vertebrae. So as we have discussed about the gray and white matter which is present inside the brain and the spinal cord, so what is the gray and the white matter? In terms of tissue, the central nervous system is divided into the gray and white matter. Gray matter basically comprises of the neuron cell bodies, that are the soma, and their dendrites, which are extending protrusions from the cell body. However, the white matter refers to the area which hosts the majority of axons. Axons which are coated with myelin, a white fatty insulating cover that helps the nerve signal quickly transfer and transfer quickly and reliably. So this myelin sheath that covers the axon is forms the white matter of the brain and spinal cord, and the cell body, which is the soma, forms the gray matter. So in case of brain, white matter is present, is buried inside the gray surface. So here we can see that the inner part of the brain consists of white matter, which is a lighter which has a lighter appearance, and the outer part, the outlining of the brain, we can see that there is a gray matter. So there is presence of cell body in the gray matter, and in the white matter there is axonal axon present. There are axons. In case of spinal cord, however, it is different. The outer layer is the spinal cord, and the outer layer is the axonal part of the cell, and the inner layer is the cell body. So after the gray and white matter, we need to know that how the cell, how the brain and the spinal cord are protected. So after the bony protection by the skull and the vertebrae, the brain and spinal cord are protected from with the help of meninges, which are basically the tissues which are providing protection to the brain and the spinal cord. The innermost there are three primary types of meninges. The innermost one is the dura mater. It is a gray, the outermost part is the dura mater, that is a gray outer layer, and the arachnoid matter, which resembles loosely woven fabric of arteries and veins, and between the arachnoid matter and the last one, pia mater, there is subarachnoid space, which is filled with the cerebrospinal fluid. So this is the vertebrae which provides protection to the spinal cord. So there are 31 structures in the vertebrae, which are named as per the their location. So they are cervical, thoracic, lumbar, sarcal, and coccyx. So in complete, the central nervous system consists of brain, which is connected to the spinal cord through the which is connected to the spinal cord, and this completely forms the central nervous system. There are various diseases which are associated with the central nervous system, which include tumors, which is excessive growth of the cells. Multiple sclerosis, in which the myelin sheath which covers the axon, that is destroyed, and which leads to deformed signal transduction. ALS, it is a myelotrophic later sclerosis, in which there is degeneration of the motor neurons. Alzheimer's disease, in which there is degeneration of neurons associated with memory in the hippocampus region of the brain. Stroke, in which there is improper supply, irregular or improper supply of the blood through the brain. Epilepsy, in which there are seizures. Parkinson's disease, in which there is degeneration of dopaminergic neurons. And leukodystrophies are various diseases, are a group of diseases which are associated with the degeneration of the spinal cord and the brain. Thank you.
Thank you, Pranupriya, for nice presentation about the basic components of central nervous system. So with this understanding, I would like to invite Dr. Miran Puri. Sir, can you please upload your presentation?
Good evening to all of you, and good morning to North Americans here sitting with me. it was a very elaborative and well detailed description discussed by the author Anupriya for the talk. I'm very much impressed. She has covered the basic part, basic anatomical parts and the functions of the brain and spinal cord, and especially referring to overall central nervous system. With this basic know-how for non-biology students, I would like to take this talk into another direction. So the first I will discuss about my main research on animal models, which is a mouse model for the spinal cord injury. I started work in this lab about 16 years before. So I chose this topic, Science Pursues Yoga's Truth. When I was young, at the age of 12 years, my father showed me a slide where it was written, Science is Pursuit of Truth. So I changed that slide, Science Pursues Yoga's Truth. So let's go further. And the topic will be yoga and neuropathy, spinal cord injury induced neuropathic pain. Can it be integrated with the treatment of neuropathy pain? Can we integrate yoga with treatment of neuropathic pain? These are the mechanisms which I have studied. The green inhibits neuropathic pain, pink promotes neuropathic pain. So in these several years, I studied on COX-2 inhibitors, WNT1, NMDA, bradykinin receptors, TRPV receptors, folic acid study, cannabinoid receptors, how to nip the spinal cord injury-induced pain, which is caused by damaged or dysfunctional nerve fibers sending evident signals to the pain centers in CNS. The mechanisms underlying neuropathic pain are not fully understood, making treatment difficult, and I tried to dig them out and working in different directions. I will be discussing some of them in my next slides. My first study was these chloride regulatory proteins, which is NKCC1, as a cation-dependent chloride transporter involved in neuropathic pain following contusion spinal cord injury. I'll show you the slide how we contuse the spinal cord injury in the rat model. And NKCC was inhibited by bumetanide. It was an inhibitor used for this. And administration of the bumetanide increased the thermal hypoglycemia and Hyde Park withdrawal latency. What is the thermal hypoglycemia? It is a response to the heat after the animal is injured. With no lysine K, which is WNT, has a regulator of NKCC1 activation by phosphorylation. And WNT1 shows their contribution in sensing and developing neuropathic pain. I touched the pathogenesis of spinal cord injury and neuropathic pain. And it was shown that increased NKCC1 may explain the observed increase in magnetic resonance image using MRI T2, exhibiting NKCC1 localization in the neurons. These data support NKCC1's role in the pathogens of acute and chronic phases of injury, namely spinal cord edema and chronic phase neuropathic pain. And this was published from our lab in Annals of Neuroscience in year 2014. And these data implicate NKCC1, role of the WNT1, and there's another isomer, HSN2, which is involved in the post-injury response that contributes to the development of the neuropathic pain. Targeting the system may have a therapeutic benefit. The next research topic was role of matrix metalloproteinases. Following neuropathic pain, these MMPs, the short form of matrix metalloproteinase, which I'll use often, MMPs are triggered to the released both as early MMP9 and the late stage of injury MMP2. At release of these triggered inflammatory cytokines, neuropathic pain after injury via interleukin-1 beta mediated activation. Tissue inhibitors of MMPs called TIMPs are used intrathecal as injections and reduce the MMP levels, decreasing amount of inflammatory markers. Following induced spinal cord injury in male adults Prague Dolly rats, we studied MMP2 in SSE induction of neuropathic pain and role of beta-catenin in Wnt signaling pathway, extracellular signaling kinase within MAP cascade. So I will not go much details of these molecular mechanism, but to go further, I use this folic acid. Folic acid is another sort of alternative medicine, which is of our interest in our studies in yoga. Folic acid modulates matrix metalloproteinases. These data from my studies, two studies, show that folic acid could alleviate neuropathic pain and improve functional recovery post-spinal cord injury, possibly by reducing the expression of MMP2. And also, we will open a novel and easy natural therapy, ideal for clinical translation with minimal side effects for managing spinal cord injury-induced neuropathic pain. Such studies might also throw light on possible epigenetic mechanisms in folic acid-induced recovery after spinal cord injury. Furthermore, we have reported the FA administration results in alleviating CSI-induced neuropathic pain by inhibiting MMP9. MMP9 is in the early stage of the induction of pain, which is will be inhibiting MMP9 in the mid phase of the spinal cord injury. And folic acid administration resulted in MMP2 decline during both mid through late phase of the spinal cord injury. So these studies were published in two papers. This is the general way of our established procedure of spinal cord injury induction in small rat model. Laminectomy at T9, thoracic 9, and which is further, we use a NYU impactor by dropping a 10 gram of weight from the height of 12.5 mm. And it will paralyze the animals. And the functional recovery, this level of our injury is such that it will be irreversible. It starts coming back. And then from the various treatment, for example, I will exemplify with the folic acid study. We give the injections before spinal cord injury, 3 days and 17 more days after spinal cord injury. So then we check them, their functional recovery by BBB scores. These are the scores established from 1 to 21 scores of BBB. We score it, how they functionally recover. One, a small movement of the limb, and then two limbs, two parts. Then, you know, the animals slowly and slowly show this improvement. So further in the, after 2 to 3 weeks, we will start studying the thermal hyperalgesia, pain testing. We start pain testing by using this equipment, which is we have an IR generator tested on day 14 to 21. The latency time of the rats using a movable IR generator tested on day 14. So it shows more the scores of thermal hyperesthesia, lesser the pain. So if the animal pick up a spar in 1 or 2 seconds, that is in pain. And if it is in 10 seconds, 14 seconds, like this. So we will be testing this at this intensity, which we use heat intensity. We will stop it if animal doesn't pick up the paw after 20 seconds, because this can burn the paw. So this is the general way how we just go. And my another topic was cannabinoid receptors. Injecting the non-selective CB receptors agonist when reduced spinal cord injury, pain, role of AEA specific fatty acid amide hydrolase and 2AG specific monoglycerol lipase as a regulator's report. Pre-treatment with CB1 antagonist, which is AM2251, had not affected the anti-hyperesthesia effect of WIN. Pre-treatment with the CB2 receptor antagonist AM630 reduced the effect of WIN significantly. Selectively activating the CB receptors and their possible therapeutic values for treating spinal cord injury patients has been discussed as a potential analgesic effect on neuropathic pain. Then, also besides this, I tested after a gene chip study, that's called fishing study, but we selected bradykinin 1 and TRPV1 receptors. So the rats for the spinal cord injury, B1 and TRPV1 receptors genes are highly expressed following injury of animal displaying thermal hyperesthesia. In animals exhibiting hyperesthesia, more than 2-fold increase in the expression of these two genes in the epicentral region of the spinal cord was observed. This finding is consistent with other findings revealing contribution of B1 and vanillite receptors in nociceptions. This was our main goal. Then, as I showed earlier, MMP9, it is a cause of induction of pain, and maintenance of the pain at the later stage is via expression of MMP2. But some of the chemokines, upregulation of signaling pathway that contribute to the pain, longer lasting and more persistent. And role of the CCL2 and CXCL1, which has contribution to the neuropathic pain. TNF-alpha activates astrocytes, induced persistent mechanical, and it is tested by mechanical allodynia. As thermal hyperesthesia is in response to the heat, mechanical allodynia is in response to the small needles of the various sizes. In nerve injury, there's an increase in excitatory synaptic transmission, which is suppressed by CBX and GAP27. And then furthermore, CX43 provides a release portal for astrocyte mediators, such as chemokines. And CX34 contributes to pain hypersensitivity in a mouse model of spinal cord injury. CX34 has a role in chronic pain maintenance after constriction injury. The intrathecal injection of CBX weakens the mechanical hypersensitivity, and after this constriction injury, spontaneous excitatory postsynaptic runs higher in CCI models of mouse compared to the control animals. So these were the results in astrocyte, which we cite as a evidence supporting the mechanism of pain. I also used COX-2 inhibitors in spinal cord contusion injury. I presented this paper in our meeting of Indian Academy of Neurosciences. And we use three COX-2 inhibitors, indomethacin, celecoxib, meloxicam. And indomethacin is a non-selective COX-2 inhibitor, which did not statistically decrease the pain sensation. But celecoxib, the COX-2 inhibitor, did significantly decrease the pain perception. Meloxicam, in both high dose and low dose, applied reduced pain perception, but it was not found significant. There was some discussion that why we are using celecoxib. Possibly in India, they are not using celecoxib. But I will say this is having, but some of the mortality kind of questions came up. In some of the groups, we saw some mortality of the rats. But the mortality of the rats reported is due to the toxic effect of this meloxicam or celecoxib. That study was little bit disturbing, that why the mortality is happening in some of the groups. Now, I will say pain tolerance in yoga practitioners. I will be mixing now with another topic, a part of the topic. It has been reported that North American yogis had more tolerance to pain. Effect of long-term and regular yoga practice on both experienced North American yogis analyzed thermal detections, pain thresholds, cold pain tolerance, brain gray matter and white matter. Yogis had increased left intrainsular white matter integrity, parasympathetic activation, and increased awareness can tolerate more pain as compared to the control group. So this was a insular cortex, the part of the cerebral cortex. And this is interesting. This is based upon a review written by me on this role of implication of spinal cord injury, implication of yoga and spinal cord injury, published. So these are the findings from that review. Iyengar yoga. Iyengar form of yoga is a boon for spinal cord patients, and it empowers strength, flexibility, and physical balance through stretching of muscles, which all of you might be knowing. Asanas in this style of yoga are modifiable and make it more innovative. Iyengar empowers the patient by building symmetric and asymmetric postures to gain flexibility and awareness of the body structure by integration of pranayama into the postures. It focuses on the weight and time management of the muscle contraction and relaxation. Then there's another study. Reaction time in these studies was analyzed in two groups of containing 35 participants, a yoga group and a control group, with a mean age of 29 years. The yoga group had a prior 6 month experience of yoga practice, while the control group was not involved in any kind of yoga practice. The yoga group was assessed in two sessions. The first was bellows breathing, and the second was breathe awareness. Assessments were made using a multi-operational apparatus for reaction time. The results demonstrated a significant reduction in the number of anticipatory responses following 18 minutes of Bastrika as compared to that before practice. One of the approaches of yoga is pranayama, a type of, you already know everything, a type of voluntary breathing regulation generally performed with the physical exercise of yoga. There are many different ways, but three steps to perform it is consistent. There is the inhalation, puraka, the retention of the breath, and kumbhaka, and finally the exhalation, rachaka. Regulation of breath in stepwise manner affects the control of autonomic nervous system, which has further benefit effects on different organ system in the body. When pranayamic breathing is performed with long breath retention, the parasympathetic nervous system is amplified, as demonstrated by lowering of the metabolic rate and oxygen consumption. In chronic pain, breathing is strained and becomes shallow and causes more thoracic muscles. If the breathing pattern can be corrected with the help of yogic breathing, then certainly it may help it in the management of the pain. Sudarshan Kriya Yoga. There are three studies. Study one was out of 30 drug-free depressed patients, 22 responded well to the treatment, which showed the effectiveness of Sudarshan Kriya in depression. Study two out of 103 Swedish individuals, 55 in Sudarshan Kriya and pranayama group and 48 individuals in the control group. At the end of 6 weeks, participants in Sudarshan Kriya and pranayama group were found to have a lower degree of anxiety, depression, and stress compared to the control group. Study three, serum BDNF levels changed after practicing a yoga module consisting of loosening exercise, asana, pranayama, and meditation based on 130C patients with a range of age 18 to 55. The first group, where the population was 23, received only yoga therapy. The second group, with 78 people, received only medication. And the third group of population 36 received yoga therapy and medication for 12 weeks. The result showed a significant decrease in Hamilton Depression Rating Scale scores of the group, three groups. But more reduction was observed in patients receiving a yoga session without medication as compared to the medication alone group. The patient suffering from depression reported antidepressant effects, which were correlated with the increased serum BDNF levels, Hamilton Depression Rating Scale score reduction, and rise in BDNF levels were reported in yoga only group. So these are the interesting studies which are already reported. Now, this yoga for PTSD, it is a post-traumatic stress disorders. University of Wisconsin Madison is testing a new treatment program for PTSD that does not involve drugs or traditional therapy. The scientists hypothesized that yoga and mindful breathing may help PTSD victims more effectively with the treatment of the disease. The Center for Investigating Healthy Minds at the University of Wisconsin is actively researching to gain the understanding of the treatment through yoga. Effect of yoga on the transmitters. Regular practice of yogic exercise has shown alternation of various transmitters in the brain. One PET study showed that during yoga, nidra, meditation increased endogenous dopamine release in the ventral striatum. In another study, a 60-minute yoga session increased the brain GABA levels as compared to controls performing a 60-minute reading. This study aimed to explore the practice of regular yoga as one of the strategies for treating anxiety and depression-related disorders. Furthermore, another study revealed that yoga practice daily for 1 hour for a period of 3 months helped in lowering ACTH and cortisol while elevating serotonin, dopamine, and BDNF in healthy active men. While concluding some of these studies, I will say the role of BDNF studied in animal models of pain, yogic practice influences the CNS, SNS, and hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. Molecular effects of yoga on pathological conditions not well established, but paved the way for future study design that examined their relation to neuropathic pain. Modern prescriptive treatment strategies and reductionist therapy pituitary approaches pertaining to a few or most of the systemic and psychological disorders have various metabolic side effects. The use of yoga will help to cope with these well-defined side effects and will boost the quality of the healthcare. Overall, concluding, the simplicity and practicality of yoga make it a viable therapy that should be utilized in rehabilitation centers or clinics in order to help ameliorate neuropathic pain. And with this, I will close my talk, but we will discuss, all of us. I will especially invite the scholars. They must join in this discussion, but they know what I want to share, so we can share this knowledge and know-how which we gain from each other. So everybody's participated. Everybody should participate in this discussion to make it a little more richer. And at the end, I'm so grateful and thankful to Dr. Akshay Anand, Professor of Neurology at PGIMER, who is my mentor in one way. He's my mentor from India. He has brought me to this platform. It's all due to him. I'm here on this platform today to join you, to share with you this know-how, little bit know-how, which I have. But I have worked in different other fields also. For example, medical microbiology, I have worked on sexual transmitted diseases for 10 years. I have worked for 10 years, including 5 years in Canada and 2 years in England. I have worked on host pathogen interactions, and I only plan the animal models. So my research is planning the animal model. I spend my whole life on the bench study with my students, and students are my pride. So I work with them. Whatsoever they give me, in turn, I publish it with them. So this is my basic day-to-day lifestyle, working on the bench with them and gaining from them a lot of experience. And last but not the least, I will thank to Parul. She is very helpful. Yesterday, she gave me a little practice on this Zoom, you know. So I'm thankful to her and sharing some information and very good steps with her. And I'm thankful to the speaker today, Anupriya, because I'm very unhappy to know that Radhika could not present and due to the circumstances, the sad demise in her family. And it's all very touching. And I'm very happy to join with you. And again, I'm very thankful to Dr. Rakesh Pandit, who introduced me in the beginning. And I was very glad to talk to him. And thank you very much. Let's discuss. Let's all discuss what where we are, where we want to go from here to there.
Thank you, Dr. Miranpuri. Sir, can you please unshare your slides? Thank you very much. So before moving on to the question answer round, I would like to introduce our another special guest, Dr. Rakesh Pandit. He's a National Secretary, Arogya Bharti member, Board of Governors for National Commission for Indian System of Medicine, member, National Council for Clinical Establishment, Government of India. So I invite Dr. Rakesh Pandit. Thank you very much for coming here. So there we have some question after your presentation. So is there any question from the students? From our yoga scholars? Prashant, do you have any questions related to pain?
Yes, sir. What is the name of your research paper? What did you done on the you mentioned, sir?
I couldn't get it.
Sir, what is the name of your research paper, sir? As you mentioned before, sir, on.
Research paper, that's the implication of yoga in spinal cord injury. That paper was published. If you can give me a minute, I'll find it.
You can click off
in the monitor, the desktop. This is a yoga. Can it be integrated with the treatment of neuropathic pain? It was written with Shirley Tallis, Natasha Sial, Kerry Knott, and my another three, four students, including me and Dr. Akshay Anand. And it was published in Integrative Medicine International. This paper has invited me to attend several meetings on yoga. And also this has been referred several times. And I have counted that it is referred about 63 times. You know, this paper, this is a review paper. Based on this review paper, I'm sharing all these, some of the slides, including my research, and I'm trying to put them together, how we can jointly work and how yoga can be integrated.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. And thank you very much for a very detailed and nice presentation. This is Sheetal, sir. So I wanted to just ask one question. As you talked about three different studies on Sudarshan Kriya, so the Sudarshan Kriya can help in pain management as well. Are there any studies or anything on that as well?
Which might be back pain or otherwise?
Sudarshan Kriya, I got this reference all from this paper, you know, which I published, Shirley Tallis, and this is my paper. So these are the reviewed informations. And the references are available only this study one, study two, and study. There are only three studies done, which are known to me.
Okay, sir. Fine. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Arul, can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Congratulations, Dr. Gurvatan, for an amazing and a comprehensive moderation of Kanupriya's talk. I was just thinking that you very nicely in the beginning introduced to us the spinal cord contusion model, animal model. And then you went on to explain the effect of yoga on parasympathetic response, then also the altered BDNF levels. So apparently when yoga and pranayama is done, whether in the form of Sudarshan Kriya, as you explained, or Iyengar yoga, as you explained. I was just sitting and wondering if we can combine the two studies together. I mean, just think about it. If we can use your model of spinal cord injury and then the separate group of yoga practitioners who are doing yoga, let us say for 1 month or 2 months, and take their blood or their blood product, which will presumably have more BDNF, as you explained, or you know, enhanced cytokines or a good neurotrophic good growth factors. And if we put them in this contused or spinal cord injury model and see if the injury is recovered better by yoga practitioners' extracts versus those who are not yoga practitioners. What do you think? This is just idea came
to me. It's a very good thought. When I'm talking about science is the pursuit of yoga truth, right? So this is really good. And the purpose of this yoga integration with our scientific information, for example, protein expression, if we can really conclude in this model, nothing like that. Nothing like that. Yeah.
Great. Thank you. And then hopefully we can, yeah, I think Dr. Rakesh has some question.
I am also a yoga student. So
yeah, Dr. Rakesh, please go ahead. We lost you somewhere, I think.
Yes, sir. He is not here, so he will join again. So before him, sir, I want to ask you that how yoga is alleviating pain. What could be the mechanism behind this?
I think this is a muscle exercise. So these expressions, how the yoga doers and the normal people, since they find the differences. This is one study. This is the effect of yoga neurotransmitters also. At the same time,
Dr. Akshay, may I ask one question?
Please go ahead. Actually, somebody just asked him how Dr. Parul was asking him, Dr. Gurvatan, that how is pain mediated by, how is pain reduced by yoga intervention? So he was just finishing his answer. If you are done, sir, can we go to Dr. Rakesh Pandit?
Just a minute.
Let him finish.
Yeah.
The insular cortex moderates increased pain tolerance in yoga. Parul, one study has shown that North American yogi, as I was saying, that they have more tolerance. They say that they have examined the effect of long-term and regular yoga practice on the experienced North yogis compared, which is they analyze the thermal detections, pain thresholds, and cold pain tolerance in both the groups. So there was a significant difference, they are reporting.
And probably it seems that more research needs to be done to actually unmask the real molecular mechanisms. And a biologist and a neuroscientist like Dr. Gurvatan need to work more closely, even though we need people like him because he's passionate about yoga. And yet his real command and the real expertise and skills rest with animal models and spinal cord injury. But in his endeavor to combine that with the yoga interventions, he needs to, and people like him will, if they collaborate with yoga academics and yoga professors, the mechanism to the pain alleviation can probably be discovered. I think that should be the message. Now we can go to, maybe Parul, you can allow Dr. Rakesh Pandit to ask his question.
Yes. My question may not be directly related to today's topic, but I have read so many papers which says that practice of yoga increase the gray matter in brain.
Exactly, sir. I was just going to say that it is written.
Yes, yeah.
Analysis of the structural changes of the yogis and the other people. Okay. Analysis of the structural changes in the brain, gray matter, and white matter have revealed that yogis had increased left intra-insular white matter integrity as compared to the controls.
Okay. I have read somewhere that due to that increase in gray matter and its quality, they were able to predict so many things of past and future also. They can correlate the past things and future predictions they could have made due to this special ability due to high level of gray matter.
And due to their parasympathetic activation and increased awareness, they are able to tolerate more pain as compared to the control group. So this study is also I picked up from the your reviews, you know, this reviews.
So maybe the increased gray matter may empower the yogis or the practitioners to have better cognitive abilities. Now, whether that cognitive ability extends to doing of a normal task more skillfully or by reduced anxiety or with better processing, better memory in one hand. And I don't know how much data we have to be able to, as Dr. Rakesh Pandit said, predict the future or
have high power to analyze the things, present circumstances which could lead to the predictions they can made.
Excellent. So that makes sense that you are able to process better with better cognitive processing and incorporating different cues and parameters and make a judgment and predict. So a predictive capability may or may not be increased, but this is a good research question definitely to take up and study that. See, back to Parul.
So is there any question from anyone?
We are also joined by Dr. Gagandeep Brad, who is an eye specialist and a person who is known to Dr. Miranpuri. If he wants to come and ask a question, and by the time he comes, we can ask other questions. But if he comes, he's welcome to come live and pose his questions. So Dr. Gurvatan, are you really... when you think of yoga, do you sometime think of coming back to India?
Yeah, I will. but it depends, you know, what is the host institute and what is going on there, the future goals, and where I will be fitting well. But my goal is to serve back home. You know, I have served 40 years here, and this is my passion, let's say. It may be difficult or what, but advisor like you, when they are on my shoulders, then I will be running very fast, no doubt. But I need good advisors like you, good supporters like you. The reason is basic discouragement should not happen. That, you know, when you go as a new person, so new experience, new place, new colleagues, and I need the support. But I am a very compassionate person. I get along with anyone. This is my beauty. Love from my life cannot finish. Science is pursuit of truth, and love from my life can. I have distributed love. And
thank you for publicly stating that you are even at this age, having left and led most of your professional life in US, you're willing to come back to India. We are also joined by Parul by Dr. Gagandeep Brad, who's an accomplished surgeon, eye surgeon from Sangam Netralay, and probably presumably a acquaintance of Dr. Gurvatan also. Please, Dr. Gagandeep, any question or any comment?
Not really. My knowledge on the subject is really...
Oh my God! Gagandeep, you recognize me?
Oh, definitely, sir. I am here because of you.
Oh my God, Gagandeep, he's my brother.
He's my brother. The surprise is for you.
Oh my God, this is my
Rakshi has brought us together.
Oh my God, that's good.
I must congratulate you on an excellent presentation. And Dr. Akshay is doing a wonderful job highlighting some of these issues with naturopathies and yoga. in the management of some of these complex neurosciences.
I'm so happy you are there. Actually, recently, there is a one ophthalmologist. She is from Harvard University. She has joined this place. She has asked me to run the show of our new research. So this is just 3 weeks before. So I was thinking that, oh, go to the new field now and all that. But anyway, my experience of 70 years, he said that, you know, you will be able to bring the new students and they can work with me and all that. So that's the ophthalmology. That's my another hub they are offering me. But I will be thinking, you know, how to manage two labs.
we will continue all these discussion. Sorry, I'm interrupting you. So I'm here looking for some question. If there are no question, is there any question from any student? So thank you, Kanupriya, for a nice presentation on the basic understanding of the brain and spinal cord. And thank you, Dr. Miran Puri, for a wonderful presentation and sharing your insights about your research work, basically on neuropathic, and also telling us the significance and importance of the yoga and neuropathic pain and the knowledge about the different asanas and how it can be used for reducing pain and what are the further research which is required for dissecting the molecular mechanism of yoga and alleviating nervous related disorders and others. So thank you very much, Dr. Gurvardhan, for joining here.